Welcome to the United Methodist Church of New Lenox. We're delighted that you're worshiping with us this morning, and we're so, so grateful for the opportunity for us to celebrate worship, even online. As of now, we're able to open for limited seating indoor worship, and you can find out all about how to reserve your seat on our website under the Worship tab, and we invite you to do so. If it appears that the services are full, always feel free to call our office to be put on the waiting list, for occasionally we do have extra space where people can come and enjoy our services in person here in the sanctuary. But this is an opportunity for all of us to experience the grace of God, for God truly loves you, and there's nothing you can do about that. And so this morning, as we enter into the great 50 days of Easter and we continue in the resurrection narratives, we invite you to experience a whole new life as you offer yourself, heart, soul, mind, and strength, into the hands of a God who loves you more than you could ever ask or imagine. And so we welcome you as we worship this day, and in a moment, we're going to hear some special music. We invite you to take some time to let us know that you're here, to click on the link, umcnl.com/here, H-E-R-E, and let us know that you're worshiping with us. You can also, at this point, begin to let others know that the peace of Christ is truly with them. And so you can send a quick text or an email or perhaps write a note to let people know that you're thinking of them. For in the midst of this worship opportunity, it truly is a time for us to let one another know that we're holding each other in prayer, that we're holding one another up, that we're surrounding one another with love and forgiveness, and that we're living into a resurrection faith. And so again, we say to you, welcome to the United Methodist Church of New Lenox.
Would you join me for the opening prayer? Lord of life, submitting to death, you conquered the grave. By being lifted on a cross, you draw all peoples to you. By being raised from the dead, you restored to humanity all that we had lost through sin. Throughout these 50 days of Easter, we proclaim the marvelous mystery of death and resurrection. For all praise is yours, now and throughout eternity. Amen.
Easter, people, praise our voices, sounds of heaven, earth should ring. Christ has brought us.
Hey kids, I'm so glad you've joined us for worship today. Today we're reading a story and Pastor Wesley's going to talk about the road to Emmaus. There are some followers of Jesus who left Jerusalem after Jesus had died and after he rose from the dead. And they were confused and sad and they didn't understand that he had risen. So they were running away, going on with their lives, and along the way Jesus joined them. But they didn't realize it was him. Until they came to a place, they sat down to eat, and Jesus broke bread. It was then, when they were about to eat, that they recognized who Jesus was. I brought something very special today. We actually used this in worship last week. This is a cup or chalice and a plate for communion or the Lord's Supper. Now, when we join together at the Lord's Supper or communion, we believe we can experience Jesus. It's perhaps one of the best ways that we can come to know Jesus better on a regular basis. Now, this particular communion set, this was handmade by my father. And growing up in my house, we didn't do this every night, but we tried to make regular times that we would sit down together as a family and we would break bread or we would share a meal. And it's around those meal times that we got to know each other and see what was going on in each other's lives, especially as I got older. And even today, as we are able to meet again, hopefully, when we get together as a family. Now, I hope your family has a special time. Maybe it's not every day. Maybe it's even just once a week where you sit down and really talk to each other over dinner or over lunch and see what's going on in your lives. And that way, we get to know each other better. And I believe we also get to know Christ better. Would you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for being known to us through communion, through breaking of bread. Thank you for letting us know others through shared meals. Lord, be with us all. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you, kids. We'll see you next week. We come to a time of prayer, and I remind you, if you have a prayer concern, you can go to umcnl.com and let us know so that our prayer team can pray for you. If you need to speak to a pastor, please, again, go to umcnl.com and be in contact with us. We would love to be in communication with you. Would you join me in a time of prayer? Lord, as we leave the cross, we often leave running away, confused and afraid and unsure of our next steps. Allow us to hold fast to the good news of the empty tomb and the resurrection. Allow us to experience you on the roads of life and in breaking bread with you and with one another. Be with all those who need your love and let us be ambassadors to them as we journey with one another. We pray this in your holy name, praying the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, starting in verse 13. On that same day, two disciples were traveling to a village called Emmaus. It's about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking to each other about everything that had happened. While they were discussing these things, Jesus himself arrived and joined them on their journey. They were prevented from recognizing him. He said to them, What are you talking about as you walk along? They stopped, their faces downcast. The one named Clopas replied, Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who is unaware of the things that have taken place over the last few days? Jesus said to them, What things? They responded to him, The things about Jesus of Nazareth. Because of his powerful deeds and words, he was recognized by God and all people as a prophet. But our chief priests and our leaders handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the one who would redeem Israel. All these things happened 3 days ago. But there's more. Some women from our group, they've left us stunned. They went to the tomb early this morning and didn't find his body. They came to us saying that they'd even seen a vision of angels who told them that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and they found the things just as the women said. They didn't see him. Then Jesus said to them, "You foolish people! Your dull minds have kept you from believing all that the prophets talked about. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and then to enter his glory?" Then he interpreted for them the things written about himself in all the scriptures, starting with Moses and going through all the prophets. When they came to Emmaus, he acted as if he was going on ahead. But they urged him, saying, "Stay with us. It's nearly evening, and the day is almost over." So he went to stay with them. After he took his seat at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Weren't our hearts on fire when he spoke to us all along the road and when he explained the scriptures for us?" May God bless the word read today. Amen.
Friends, let us pray. Lord, as we open our hearts and minds to you, we ask that you would silence any voice within us except that of your own. Help us to hear what it is that you would say to us this day, so that we may truly follow you with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. In this we pray, in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. This is the season of Easter, and the season of Easter starts with the great 50 days beginning on the Sunday of Resurrection and leads us all the way to the day of Pentecost, which is coming in the latter part of May. And so this season is one in which we're going to take a look at various resurrection appearances. There are several that are throughout the Gospels, and so we're going to spend a few weeks taking a look at the various responses and the various ways in which the disciples reacted to the resurrection from Easter Sunday until the time of Christ's ascension. And so each of these particular narratives that we're going to be delving into captures a particular response of the disciples. And so all of us at times have felt one of these varied responses, and so this will be a season in which we explore the resurrection. Today we turn our attention to those who were essentially running away. The last Sunday when we talked about Easter, when Pastor Mark originally opened up the season of Easter, he was talking about how we proclaim that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Come on, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. I know, I was watching because a couple of you there really didn't respond very well. And I know it feels a little awkward when you're in your home, but I encourage you, go ahead and yell out loud at the screen that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. That was a little better, but I'm sure you could do even better than that. Last Sunday, we talked about how Mary ran to the tomb. And when she and the other women discovered that the tomb was empty, they went back and told the disciples. And Peter and the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved, ran to the tomb. And of course, the other disciple outran Peter, which I just candidly love that story. As if the author of that particular chapter of the gospel wanted to rub it in our faces that he could run faster than the apostle Peter. But then after they discovered that the tomb was empty, they went back to the room where the other disciples were. And it was Mary of Magdala. That's why we call her Mary Magdalene. Mary stayed in that place near the tomb and was the first person. She was the very first person to encounter the resurrected Christ. Today, we get to see the next two people who are the ones to encounter the resurrected Christ on Easter Sunday. And so, I know that Easter was celebrated last week, but just for a moment, go with us in heart and mind to that first Easter Sunday morning. This is the story of the Emmaus journey. It happens on Easter morning with two disciples who had heard what was going on, and then they walked away. There are three major questions that we'll address or that we'll ask so that we can wrestle with some of these questions throughout the week. And the first major question, the first major point for this morning is, how well do we know the story of Jesus? The disciples, Cleopas and the other disciple, are making their way towards the village of Emmaus. It's about a 7-mile journey down toward Emmaus. And as they're strolling along, they discover that someone else is strolling along with them. And so Jesus walks up to them and essentially asks what in the world they're talking about. And they look at him as if he's some sort of a goof. Are you the only one in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there these few days? And Jesus does a very fascinating thing. He actually says, what things? Rather than respond to the question at hand of, yes, I'm the only one that has no idea what's going on in Jerusalem, he invites them to tell their story. He invites them to actually share how they're feeling. But here's the thing. If we were actually the ones strolling along, if we were actually the ones walking along with Jesus, how well could we tell his story? For that's exactly what they do. They begin and they start sharing all of their hopes and their dreams, all that they had anticipated and all that they had hoped for from this Jesus until he was crucified. And even though they heard the rumors of resurrection, they're still walking away. But notice how Jesus listens to their story, how he interacts with them, how he invites them to actually share everything that they had experienced, all that was on their heart, all that they were feeling. He doesn't shush them. He doesn't correct them. He doesn't shame them for their unbelief. Well, he comes back to that a little later, but he invites them to share their story. He seems interested in them. After all, they seem to have all the highlights together. They had clearly heard that something had happened. They heard that the tomb was empty. They heard that Peter had gone to the tomb with the other disciple. They heard that the tomb was empty, and yet they were still walking away. Something profound had reportedly happened, and here they were wandering off. I mean, how could they not explore that? How could they not know? How could they have been so blind to what was right in front of them? And then I think there are experiences in my life where I have been completely blind to realities that I just wasn't aware of. I mean, I think back to when I got my first job. My dad would go and visit with a few of his friends at Hardee's every single Saturday morning. At 5 a.m. on Saturday, we were there when Hardee's first unlocked the doors, and we'd have a little group. We would share coffee, maybe a little breakfast, and just chat, you know, like for an hour and a half. It's what some of you may have done in the past, is just gather at a restaurant and just chew the fat for a couple of hours. That's what we did. And every Saturday morning, you know, invariably, the conversations might not be necessarily that exciting to me, and I would try to find something else to do to kind of occupy my mind. And I discovered Hardee's had these little comment cards. They wanted to know about our experience. And, you know, I was always fascinated with the person who always opened the door for us. She was so kind. She was so gracious. She was so welcoming and so hospitable, which was quite a feat at that hour in the morning. And so I began filling out comment cards. I talked about how Teresa was so kind, so friendly, and was so jovial. And it was such a wonderful blessing for us to be able to go in first thing in the morning. And I did not know. I mean, I was completely blind to the fact that her name tag said manager. And I didn't know what a manager did. I was 15, for crying out loud. And then she looks at me and she says, Wesley, how old are you? And I said, I'm 15. And then she says, you know, we do hire 15-year-olds. Here's an application. To which, okay. But I wasn't looking for a job. I had other things on my plate. I was completely blind to the reality of what she was offering. And the next Saturday we came in, you know, 5 o'clock, doors open, we walk in, we chew the fat a little bit and walk up to the counter, and there she is again, Teresa, this very kind, welcoming, hospitable person. And she looks at me and she says, Wesley, we didn't get your application. It's because I didn't fill one out. So I took an application, I filled it out, you know, and I was in high school and I was involved in band and theater and all kinds of things. I mean, my hours were really next to nothing. I wasn't available for anything. But I figure if you want me for a few hours on a Saturday, I'm game. And no Sundays, because my dad always told me, thou shalt never work on Sundays. It's another story entirely. But the next Saturday, I went in, and I'd filled out the application with my exceedingly limited number of hours that I would be able to work. I handed Teresa the application, and she said, "When can you start?" And that was the beginning of my job, completely blind to a reality in front of me. The same thing is somewhat true when I entered ministry. I remember ending up in a district superintendent's office, and I didn't know what a district superintendent was. It turns out idiocy has really served me very well. I know how to be completely ignorant, and as a 20-year-old, walked into a student charge, starting to serve two churches as a computer science major, fluent in several computer languages at the time, and not really knowing a whole lot about how the discipline of the church actually worked. You see, the disciples are blind to the reality of what's right in front of them, but they bring their life experience and they share their stories, and who they are comes to bear when they're in the presence of Jesus. And Jesus eventually clarifies everything. So they begin to go through the entire story. Jesus shares with them the story about who he really is, starting with Moses and moving through the prophets and engaging in the entirety of the Hebrew Scriptures. But the only way to really know about Moses and the prophets and to really work your way through the understanding of how this thread of love works its way throughout the entire scope and tenor of Scripture is to be devoted to the Word. It's to be devoted to the reading of our Scripture. And you know, sometimes that's tough for us, even with familiar passages. We encounter familiar passages and we just want to skip. Yeah, I know that part. But the thing is, we cannot simply skip over even the most familiar. Are we willing to spend time with the Word? Are we willing to wrestle with the texts that simply don't make any sense? Are we willing to discover the thread of the unconditional love and grace that flows within the story so that when we encounter Jesus on our own roads, when we seem to be wandering or running away, we encounter the incredible grace that God would extend to us? And so the first major question for this morning is, how well do we actually know our story? The second major question for us to wrestle with from the text of this day is, how well do we recognize other disciples? And what I mean by other disciples is there are two disciples who are on their way from Jerusalem to Emmaus, about a 7-mile journey. It's Cleopas and it's another disciple. We don't know who it is. As a matter of fact, we have no idea who they are. It's clear from the various gospel accounts and from the gospel authors that we're not keenly aware of everybody who was involved or hanging around with Jesus for the entirety of his ministry. As a matter of fact, after the resurrection, it's in the book of Acts that records that they were going to find another disciple, another person who is going to replace Judas after Judas had taken his life. And so when they're looking for the person to replace Judas, here are the qualifications for somebody to be one of the apostles. It's from Acts chapter 1, beginning at verse 21. "Therefore, we must select one who has accompanied us during the whole time that the Lord Jesus lived among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when Jesus was taken from us. The person must become, along with us, witnesses to the resurrection." And there are two names that are proposed, and neither one of them is Cleopas. There are two disciples on the road to Emmaus, but we don't have a clue who they are. We don't know who belongs to Jesus, and that's one of the most incredible points of this particular narrative. Often we think it's pretty easy to determine who's a disciple and who's not. And we think it's pretty easy to draw a circle. Well, if you're part of this group, you're in. If you're part of that group, you're out. But the truth is, we have no clue who the disciples actually are. We don't know who these two people are. But then we read in the entirety of the New Testament, God so loved the world that he gave his only son. It's in John chapter 10 when Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd." And the good shepherd lays down his sheep and he makes this one startling comment, "I have sheep in other pastures that you don't know about." In other words, there are disciples that are keenly aware of and are highly devoted to God without us ever recognizing that they're part of the group, that they're part of what God is doing in the world. United Methodists would call this prevenient grace, a grace that goes before us, the grace of God that is thoroughly embedded in the resurrected Christ that is available to all of us in and through the Holy Spirit. That grace of God, that love of God, that God loves the world, It's available to everyone, and everyone has access to that. So we don't even know who Cleopas is. There's speculation in various commentaries, but we don't know. I mean, it's in John 19 when we find out that the people who went, who were at the cross, John 19 says this. It's here. That at the cross, Jesus' mother, which was Mary, and his mother's sister, who was also named Mary. Mary was the wife of Clopas. Clopas is not exactly spelled the same as Cleopas, and that Clopas appears nowhere else in the Bible either. And then there was Mary Magdalene. In other words, there were three Marys at the cross, according to the Gospel of John. There was Mary and her sister Mary. And so some people think if that Mary, the wife of Clopas, was the person who is Cleopas in Luke's gospel, then it could have potentially been Jesus' aunt and uncle. But ultimately, we don't know. We don't know who Cleopas is. So what in the world is so special about Cleopas and this other disciple? The people who are walking away from Jerusalem, what's so special about them? Except that they are the first men to see the resurrected Christ. Mary in the garden was the first person to see the resurrected Christ. These are the first men to see the resurrected Christ. And they aren't listed in the group of the 12 disciples who become apostles. And they aren't really even known to us throughout the rest of the entire New Testament witness. So why does Jesus show up to these two runaways first? Who knows? But what we glean from that is it's not about inner circles. It's not about getting perks. It's not about having insider knowledge. The grace of God actually seeks out people that we're not even aware are full disciples. Knowing Jesus really does not make any of us better than anyone else. It doesn't elevate our status. And that doesn't even account for church membership. I mean, you want to know about church membership? It's about being committed to serve God and to love others, to make a difference in the world through a specific community of faith. That's why when we join a church, we take vows. And it's kind of like our marriages, right? You know, how do you know if you've found the right church? Well, stop looking elsewhere, right? How did I know that I'd marry the woman of my dreams? I quit looking for someone else. We let go of our, what kids call FOMO, our fear of missing out somewhere else. So we dive into a self-sacrificial, benevolent, caring, agape relationship with a community of faith. And if we get this right, then we begin to live into the vision of what it is to be the salt of the earth, the light of the world. I mean, if we hear nothing else from this morning's sermon, here's what I would really strenuously desire for all of us to capture. That if we are really going to follow Jesus, if we're really going to live into a resurrection life, then we need to ask, how is it we're going to treat other people? How is it we're going to treat others who may indeed be faithful followers without necessarily belonging to our group? It's why our congregation does everything we can to assist with the least of these. Whatever you have done for the least of these, that's the mark of discipleship. And that's why we do what we can to volunteer our time, our talents, our strength, our muscles, to make a difference in the world, to feed people even right now. And so the second major question for this morning is this: how well do we really recognize other disciples? Because they aren't necessarily who we think they are. The third major question for us to wrestle with is, are we actually willing to participate in the feast with Jesus? The two disciples go on with Jesus. Their hearts are burning along the way, and they recognize Jesus finally in the breaking of the bread. When he takes the time to bless the bread, to raise the bread, bless the bread, break the bread, share it with the disciples. There are several times when Jesus has broken bread with the people around him throughout the entirety of the Gospels. The feeding of the 5,000, the feeding of the 4,000, and especially at the Last Supper. when Jesus said, take and eat. When he gathered with people, that was where miracles happened, was around the dinner table. It's beautiful how Pastor Mark talked about what it means to gather as a family and actually have conversations, to gather around the table and get to know one another, because the table isn't always filled with the people with whom we always agree. That the gathered disciples at the Last Supper were people who would eventually betray Jesus, one who would deny he had any existence or any knowledge of him. They gathered at the table with people who had vast political differences, sinners, even a tax collector was at the table. I want to talk about a vision of the church. A vision of the church is where all are welcome. I had a colleague once who would always offer a table grace, and it was always fun to ask him to pray whenever we'd gather as a cluster of clergy. He'd say, Lord, bless this food and the sinners I have to eat it with. And then we'd all chuckle, and then he'd offer a beautiful prayer. Because we recognized that when we gathered to share a meal together, we did so with sinners, like us. We did so with outcasts, like us. We did so with broken people, just like us. We did so with runaways, just like us. We ate with ignorant know-it-alls, just like us. And then every time we come back to the table with Christ, we're reminded that Christ invites to the table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and who seek to live in peace with one another. Around the table, we are all called to gather with those people. And the question is, when we gather at the table, are we the expert or are we the student? Are we the know-it-all or are we willing to be the disciple? Are we the host of the feast or are we merely guests at the table of the Lord? Because that's what Jesus does with these two disciples. He joins them and they recognize him as the host. A vision of a church that lives into resurrection life is a church that is willing to acknowledge that God loves all of us. That God's love is actually bigger than we would ever care to admit. That God's love is actually available to everyone, regardless of skin color, regardless of ethnicity or racial background, regardless of our countries of origin, regardless of how much we agree or disagree, regardless of our political differences or personal beliefs, regardless of, fill in the blank, because the list could go on and on and on. The love that God has for us is a regardless love. It's unconditional. It's self-sacrificial. It's benevolent. It's one kind of love that we are called both to claim and then to extend. We claim God's love and are reminded God loves you and there's nothing you can do about it. But that is not a selfish love, it's a regardless love, a reckless love that then must be shared. When Cleopas and the other disciple meet at the table, they become the student. They become the guest. They fully see and recognize Jesus when they allow Jesus to be the host. And they ask, were not our hearts on fire? And so the major question, the third major question for us to wrestle with is, are we willing to participate in the feast with Jesus? Brennan Manning is the person who offers one of the most pointed and yet beautiful quotes with which I continue to wrestle. Says the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today are Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips but walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. That's what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. And so the questions for us this day would be, how well do we know our story? How well do we recognize other disciples? And are we willing to participate in the feast with Jesus? Let us pray. This morning, O Lord, even when we feel the urge to run away, would you remind us that your love never leaves us or forsakes us, never abandons us, and never leaves us to wander off, for you are always there for us. And so, God, would you continually challenge us to expand our horizons, to broaden the ways that we see one another and the ways that we see the world, so that ultimately we begin to be molded and shaped by your agape love. Would you call us once more to follow you with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, so that we can ultimately encourage one another, to provoke one another to love and good deeds, that we may love our neighbor as we love ourselves. For all that you do for and in us, we offer our prayers to you in the matchless, precious, powerful name of the resurrected Christ. Amen. Friends, this morning, as we have an opportunity to always think through our generosity, we encourage you to pray about the ways in which God is moving you to offer your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings. This is an opportunity to participate in the ministry of a church that genuinely is interested in making an enormous difference in the world around us. In fact, even as we record this right now, there's a semi-load of food being distributed right outside the windows here. It's a chance for us always to reach out in love and service to our neighbors, for that is what we're genuinely called to do, to be thinking about, to be in ministry with those around us.
Would you join me in the prayer of dedication? Jesus, Lord of life and new beginnings, we present our time, our talents, and our treasures to you this day. We pray that we may truly be Easter people, living into the resurrection. Bless these tithes and offerings, that they may be used to build us up as your body, as we seek to share the good news of the empty tomb. Amen. Thank you.
As we leave this place, know always that the living Lord will go with you, above you to watch over you, beneath you to lift you from grief and sorrow, beside you to befriend you, behind you to encourage you, before you to show you the way, and always within you to give you the gifts of faith, hope, and love. My dear friends, go forth always in grace and in peace, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.